today's gospel, the rich young man had an area of his life that he was not willing to surrender to God. In this case, it was money, his finances, his riches. We're living in a time when there are many people who profess Christ with their lips, but will not let him into their politics. So we want to consider this a little bit as we approach the elections in a few weeks. I really don't like preaching on this subject. Part of it's probably my woundedness and not liking the backlash that sometimes happens. I mean, a lot of people are simply cowards and just don't say anything or just are gossip. But the fact is that so many people are irrational when it comes to the subject of politics and voting. I'm going to read little excerpts from a document from the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith issued in the year of our Lord 2002 to bounce off some of these, to springboard from some of these ideas. The point here is that they say that a kind of cultural relativism exists today, evident in the conceptualization and defense of an ethical pluralism, meaning there's different ways of looking at morality, which sanctions the decadence and disintegration of reason and the principles of the natural moral law. This is true in most walks of life. You just have to go on social media to see just how insane people have gotten, but it's even worse when it comes to politics. We have to remain rational and charitable. The fact is that there is no one in Washington or in any capital that doesn't deserve some criticism. There are people who propose evil things in Washington and in all capitals. But that does not mean that gives us license to be uncharitable when we are speaking about them or if we have the opportunity to them. We must maintain charity and remember that that person that you're swearing at on the TV has a soul which is going to heaven or hell, and you have the ability to help them get to heaven if you are charitable. And that means in our interactions with other people, we must maintain charity. You are not going to agree with everybody. You are going to speak with people who are objectively wrong, and you are right. You might have to shake the dust from your feet, but that never means that we are allowed to be irrational and uncharitable with them. The other reason that I have difficulty with this topic is ignorance. Now, part of this is deliberate. In fact, there's very deliberate. I know there's a deliberate program in place to make us be ignorant or to keep us in ignorance about these topics, especially when it comes to politics. For example, if I were to poll you right now, there would be people who would raise their hand and say yes if I asked you if we were a democracy. That's because presidents and representatives and congressmen and judges and the media constantly use the phrase our democracy. This is not an outright democracy. And if you don't know what I mean by that, there's your homework. Because you have an obligation, if you are eligible to vote or will be eligible to vote, to know what that means. And I'm not going to just give you everything. I could also ask, and actually I'm going to ask this one, how many people have actually read the Constitution of the United States? Notice how most of them are old. Okay? That's because it's not required like it should be. And it's not required, of course, on purpose, because we don't want our people knowing what it actually says. It's a little bit like, never mind, we'll go. The point is that you need to read it. If you are eligible to vote and have not read the Constitution, you have a couple of weeks, but you need to read it. Those of you who are not yet eligible to vote need to read it. Is it a perfect document? Of course not. We're Freemasons, most of the authors, absolutely. But it's still the governing document of this country, and we would be in a better place if we actually followed it. I'll give you a very simple example. One of the principles in the Constitution is actually a Christian principle. I mean, there may be more than one, but definitely this one. It doesn't call it this, but it's the principle of subsidiarity. Subsidiarity means everything should be handled at the lowest level possible. And yet, how many people simply assume that presidential candidates speaking about what they're going to do in office is something which they are allowed to do or should be doing? It's because they have convinced us that that is the way things should work. Nothing should be handled at a level higher than it should be. There are plenty of things that do not need to be handled at the federal level, but we have conceded that. There are things that don't even need to be handled at the state level, but we've conceded that. And the more we are lazy, uninformed, and not participating, the more this happens. Another example of a brainwashing of a false teaching that's very common is the phrase separation of church and state. The phrase separation of church and state does not exist in the governing documents. There is a clause, it's called the Establishment Clause, and it forbids the federal government from establishing a religion. Great, I prefer to have a Christian king, but if I can't have that, otherwise government leave my religion alone. Okay? But how many of you, you don't have to raise your hands because you may not even be aware of it, but how many of you have come to understand it even subconsciously as meaning that you can't bring religion into politics? How many people tell you you cannot bring your faith into a discussion about politics? It is not what this says. It says the government cannot do so. Doesn't mean we can't. And in fact, we have this wonderful lie. Actually, sorry, before I talk about that, let me just give a couple of lines again from the document from the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith. First of all, you as Christians have an obligation to engage in this. For example, it says, by fulfilling their civic duties, guided by a Christian conscience, the lay faithful exercise their proper task of infusing the temporal order with Christian values. This whole idea, I can't impose my personal beliefs when I vote. That's what a vote is. That's what a vote is. Anyone who says they can't impose their personal beliefs by voting shouldn't be voting. The minute you vote, you are imposing your personal belief, or at least trying to. What else does it say? It is not the church's task to set forth specific political solutions. It is, however, the church's right and duty to provide a moral judgment on temporal matters when this is required by faith and the moral law. And of course, the church does that in practice through its members. The appeal often made to the rightful autonomy of the participation of lay Catholics in politics needs to be clarified. All the faithful are well aware that specifically religious activities, such as the profession of faith, worship, administration of sacraments, theological doctrines, interchange between religious authorities and the member of religions, are outside the state's responsibility. Those who, on the basis of respect for individual conscience, would view the moral duty of Christians to act according to their conscience as something that disqualifies them from political life would be guilty of a form of intolerant secularism. So yeah, let's just disabuse ourselves of the idea that our faith must be separate from our politics. Voting is a deliberate act, and as a deliberate act, it is therefore subject to all of the principles of morality. Again, I do not not understand in this irrationality how anyone can say, my faith in Jesus Christ teaches me this, but I can vote differently and that's okay. Do not understand a reasonable human being that can do that. What does this mean in practice? Well, you need to vote for, just kidding, I'm not going to tell you who you're going to vote for, although thanks to how messed up everything is, it does come out pretty simply in a lot of ways. First of all, we have to put the most important issues first. And that's the biggest problem, I think, among Christians, is they put their pet peeves first instead of what's objectively important. So, for example, I just realized there's a really long quote here, and I don't think I'm going to give you the whole thing. When political activity comes up against moral principles that do not admit of exception, compromise, or derogation, the Catholic commitment becomes more evident and laden with responsibility. This is the case with laws concerning abortion and euthanasia. Analogously, the family needs to be safeguarded and promoted based on monogamous marriage between a man and a woman and protected in its unity and stability in the face of modern laws on divorce. Of course, it goes then into other moral areas as well, but that is the biggest one. What if, however, in considering all of this, we don't have good choices? And let's face it, we don't. We don't have anyone who is a pillar of virtue, who follows Christ, who is a shining example of how to live as a Christian and as a citizen. We could choose to abstain, and some people do that, but again, it's a deliberate choice, and this is my opinion, although I think it is backed up by people who actually count, that it is still a deliberate choice, and therefore your deliberate choice is to agree with whatever the outcome is. Not dogmatic, but I will stand by that, okay? Now, we can vote, and we should vote according to a conscience formed according to the mind of Christ. Because of the nature of voting and the options we have to choose from, we can either vote for the absolute best candidate, or we can cast a vote to prevent a worse candidate from winning the election, given how things normally go. And this is part of that longer quote that I didn't do earlier, but it applies here. It's very interesting that they, invoking Pope John Paul II, they say, he continued the constant teaching of the Church, has reiterated many times that those who are directly involved in lawmaking bodies have a grave and clear obligation to oppose any law that attacks human life. For them, as for every Catholic, it is impossible to promote such laws or to vote for them. As John Paul II has taught in his encyclical letter, Evangelium Vitae, for the non-Latinists, that's the gospel of life, regarding the situation in which it is not possible to overturn or completely repeal a law allowing abortion which is already in force or coming up for a vote, an elected official whose absolute personal opposition to procured abortion is well known, could licitly support proposals aimed at limiting the harm done by such a law and lessening its negative consequence at the level of general opinion and public morality. To apply that to voters and on lawmakers, basically we can do damage control, since there are no good, clear options. There is a difference in all the candidates that are available, and their stated positions and their parties are different enough that it's clear that there is definitely a different degrees of aligning with the teachings of Christ. So if you choose to vote and to tell others for whom you voted, you also want to make sure that you make clear to them that you're not voting for that person because of their bad positions, but because of their good positions and to reduce the evil done. Again, it's messy. We don't have a lot of good options. And therefore, You might have to hold your nose, as the saying goes, as you pull the lever. Of course, you don't do levers, it's all digital, and that is a whole other story, which I won't go into now. But the point is that it's not an easy thing. It's not necessarily even a pleasant duty. It's certainly not a pleasant duty to listen to politicians, but we do have an obligation to do what we should as our citizens in the form of government that we have. And I want to just conclude this by bringing this back to Christ in a more direct way, bringing it back to our faith in a more direct way. There are two errors which the CDF are trying to get us to avoid in our attitude towards our participation in political life. The first is, Christians must reject political positions and activities inspired by a utopian perspective, meaning everything can be perfect, which, turning the tradition of the biblical faith into a kind of prophetic vision without God, makes ill use of religion by directing consciences towards a hope which is merely earthly and which empties or reinterprets the Christian striving towards eternal life. In other words, to make it more simple, we cannot reject ideas of making heaven on earth as if this is our homeland and the ultimate goal. It is a mistake to think that because we have here no lasting city, so this is the other side of that, but seek the city which is to come, we are entitled to shirk our earthly responsibilities. May Christians be proud of the opportunity to carry out their earthly activity in such a way as to integrate human, domestic, professional, scientific, and technical enterprises with religious values, under whose supreme direction all